The signatories of this letter are the mayor and all the members of the city council. We're writing to ask your help in dissuading the Albany Lions Club. They're the people with the easement to maintain the cross. From initiating litigation against this small city. We're appealing to you on the basis of lying principles set forth in your organizational literature, including community service, non-sectarianism, and constructive dispute resolution. First, we want to say we think the Lions Club is great. You know. Briefly, the situation as follows. That I really don't need to read. But I think I already went over the basic thing that originally happened. And then in 73, through a series of transactions that became extremely controversial, the land with the cross on it was transferred to the city of Albany for use as a public park. The parcel was burdened with an easement in favor of Albany Lions Club, Lions International. For ingress and egress to maintain the existing cross standing on that portion of the premises. Here's where it gets good. It gets really good. The city of Albany has recently been approached by a local organization, East Bay Atheists, which is concerned about the presence of a sectarian religious symbol on public land. The local group's been joined by two national organizations, which I mentioned earlier, in requesting the cross be removed. East Bay Atheist has raised additional issues about the safety of the cross and its electrical service line. We've reached out to the Albany Lions Club about these issues, and it's threatened to sue. If we take action regarding the cross that they perceive to be in violation of their legal rights as an organization. As the body of elected officials, we would like to be able to decide the issues surrounding the cross based on constitutional and democratic principles rather than on litigation risk considerations such as the potential cost of attorney's fees. And a lot of these people are lawyers, by the way. We, of course, intend to comply with the Constitution, separation of church and state, free exercise. Here's where it gets good. We wish to be respectful of the religious sensibilities of our community, which has become a very diverse place over the years. For example, Albany is now the locale of an important local Muslim foundation and a respected Buddhist priory. Albany's Jewish community has grown significantly, members of other faith communities, as well as atheists and agnostics, several of which are on the council, of diverse family backgrounds are represented here as well. The city council wishes to avoid creating the incorrect impression that it favors or endorses any particular religion. I mean, that is a very strong statement, and they've really been pushed to saying this because of the pressure we've applied. Plus, we've actually done a lot of education. I gave them documentation from the assessor's office of who owns the land. It goes on, here's the signatures of all the city council members. They also included a letter from us, a letter from the Freedom from Religious Foundation threatening a lawsuit, same thing from Americans United. Just about everybody has been addressed with this, and we were told that we could spread it, make it public as much as we felt was appropriate. So. All I can say is things are really changing, and it's really appropriate that they should be changing in the Bay Area, and the only reason they aren't changing more quickly is that much of our community is going increasingly toward just social organizations, and the result of that is that a lot of There's a lack of activism. We're trying to counterbalance that. You know, we got the Ten Commandments out of the Oakland Zoo 3 years ago. I think we're going to win this, too. And it's not that bad of a fight, you know. It's actually very fun. So if you would like to join in the future, feel free. And I will, at this point, stop boring you with this stuff. and get to the speaker, which is the reason that you came here originally. We have Paul Bracken, I'm not going to name names, who is a science writer who's going to speak to us about issues of having an atheist perspective and dealing with the reality of mortality. So please welcome him. Oh yeah, Jim, would you like to make a quick announcement while we're waiting?
Yeah, thank you.
This planned interruption so Jim can mention a meeting.
Yeah, I'm with Bay Area Humanist, and next week, Sunday, at this very spot, we're having a meeting at 3 o'clock, and the featured speaker will be a guy named Osama, who is a gay refugee from Jordan. And he's been working with a group called Rainbow Street. So this is a group trying to help gays get out of these religious countries where they're persecuted. And this particular organization is mostly Arab countries, but there are other organizations trying to help people get out of Russia and many African countries, so all over the world. So I think it's important that we as secular people, you know, support these people who are trying to do this. So please come if you can. It's on the meetup, and we hope to see you.
What time?
3 o'clock.
3 o'clock. Thanks.
By the way, I think Bay Area Humanists is a great group, and Jim has always been outstanding in cooperating with me at running the meetup group, trying to, you know, reach compromises. It's like, you don't meet on their established meeting days, and we don't meet on your established meeting days. And he's been the most cooperative of all. So, good group. Okay, Paul.
All right, let's get started. I can give you my full attention now. Got the technology out of the way. So, how much time do we have?
We need to be out here about 3:30, quarter to 4.
Oh, that's so
much time. Yeah. So, you know, about an hour, 45 minutes, an hour for the talk, and then discussion.
Yeah. All right. So, I'll try to confine myself to maybe 50 minutes, no more than an hour, like you said, and then we can do some questions. I can't promise to know everything about mortality, but I do know quite a bit, having written a book on the topic. If you do have a question that you can't hold on to, then by all means, just, you know, stop me and we'll deal with it right there. Especially if it's something that you're gonna forget.
There is a microphone there. If you
can, you guys hear me without the mic?
Yeah.
Okay. That way I can walk around and make sure you guys don't fall asleep and do interesting things. My background is in planetary science. Originally I worked with the Planetary Society and used to give a lot of presentations about those sorts of topics, astronomy. So you might ask, well, why did I branch out into mortality and other things? Well, a couple of reasons. When I decided I wanted to write a book about a lot of different things, mortality for me was a topic that tended to take you into all kinds of stuff. You start thinking, okay, mortality, the perspective of human beings in an enormous cosmos and great expanse of time and space, so you start thinking about cosmological things. When you ask the question, what is the nature of human identity, where did we come from, then that takes you into anthropology and you start actually thinking about things like religion as well. So when you ask, well, what has atheism got to do with mortality? Well, that's quite a lot to do with it, because mortality is often framed in a religious context. Right? When we think about mortality as sentient beings, intelligent beings, we tend to start trying to figure out a purpose for life, and that brings us to start thinking about gods and stuff like that. And then for an atheist, when you don't have those sort of religious interpretations of what happens when you die, then that mortality presents a particular problem for you. So some technologists will ask, well, is it possible to survive death? Is it possible not to die at all, and we don't have to worry about it? So that naturally then takes you into other questions like, well, what is the nature of life itself? What is it that we would need to preserve if you wanted to continue living forever? So a lot of interesting questions. And so folks that have responded to me, having read my book, have usually either complained that there's too much in it, because I'm talking about aliens and life on other planets and the neuroscience and the brain, And other people say they really like it for exactly the same reason. And that's exactly what I was trying to achieve, was to find a topic that for me would allow me to talk about all kinds of stuff. Because you know, science for me has always been, I've been very passionate about science as a way of thinking and solving problems and understanding the universe. And then the other reason is that mortality for me is something that, you know, when I thought about what should I write about, I thought about my conversations with my grandfather when I was a kid about that very topic. Because for me as a kid, mortality was one thing that the grown-ups didn't seem to have a handle on. I mean, you know, they hadn't quite figured it out. You know, you ask them, well, what happens when you die? And you get questions and answers about heaven and that kind of stuff. But it didn't seem that, like, the explanations were a little half-baked. They hadn't got, you know, if you kept probing, there was a point where the adult would say, well, you know what, stop asking questions. And I wanted to not stop asking questions. For me, that's why I like science, because you continue to ask those questions. And so on the topic of mortality and death, it seemed to me that it's a topic that we, as a society, treat in one of two ways, either with religion, or we don't think about it at all. We try not to, try to put it out of our minds. That's generally the approach that we take, and there's a reason for that. We're going to talk about it a little bit. I want to start by talking about the human brain, and you might say, well, what's the human brain got to do with anything? Well, it actually has a lot to do with everything. The brain is where all of our ability to comprehend the topic that I'm talking about, our mortality, our eventual demise. Well, without one of these, we wouldn't be able to do that. And for us to start thinking about, well, the explanations that we have about what happens when we die, and the gods and religion and the stuff that we try to keep separate from state. Well, those sorts of things, again, to understand the origin of religion and why we always have religious interpretations of what happens when we die, you have to understand how this human brain developed. Where did it come from? And why is it structured, and why does it work the way it does? And then if you want to go further and say, okay, well, what if, you know, what if we were looking for ways to prolong life and avoid death entirely? Again, it comes back to, well, what's the nature of personal identity? And that also resides inside the brain. In fact, it doesn't reside anywhere else. For anything at all to be important, you have to be conscious, you have to be aware, and you have to be able to think about the world in abstract ways, and the brain is what allows you to do that. And if you ever did want to survive death in a way that didn't involve supernatural occurrences, you'd have to figure out a way of preserving what's in that human brain. Each one of us has one of these devices. It's the most complicated machine that exists on the planet. And it's only through, it would only be through being able to preserve the memories and the experience and the consciousness that allows you to actually think and for it to feel like something to be you. All of those things are made possible by the workings of the human brain, including, by the way, religion. And why do I say that? Well, I suppose, simply put, we are different from the other animals that we share the planet with, mainly in the extent to which we can think about things in abstract ways, in symbolic thinking. Right? We're sitting in a room here talking about something fairly abstract from the point of view of a dog or some other kind of animal. It would have no way of comprehending what's going on here. The objects in the room, the projector, the chairs that you're sitting on, all of this means something to us. You're interpreting what I'm saying in a certain way that is beyond the capability of other animals. They just can't do that, right? If an animal can't sniff something, it doesn't exist as far as it's concerned. And there are creatures that can get stressed about things, but not to the extent that people do, right? If a deer is being stalked, it can get very stressed, but once the danger has passed, it carries on about its business and the stress, you know, subsides. Humans can deliberate, think, and worry about things for long periods of time, and stress, you know, is actually a leading factor in a lot of diseases. So humans have that unique ability, and that's what allows us to actually contemplate things like, well, why did my friend die? You know, what was that all about? And without any good obvious reason, you tend to invent them. And that's where we believe religion came from. It came as a rational response to trying to understand things that are really not possible to understand. The brain as a machine is a very intricate machine. And as a matter of fact, you know, most machines in nature are more complex than what we can build today. You know, we can build aircraft that can fly at extreme altitudes. We can build computing, thinking devices. But we still can't build anything as complicated as these entities here. If we wanted to build something similar, you know, the brain as a machine is far more complicated than even the most advanced digital computers or radio telescopes or any artifacts that we can build using our human brains, right? So, and I'll explain that a little bit more because I think it is relevant to understanding when you hear things, people talking about, well, it won't be long before we can live forever and we can re-engineer human brains and make artificial brains. If there's one thing I want to convey, it is how far away that possibility is. It's not as close as what you might think from looking at shows like Nova or Science Now or any of that stuff. Right? The brain, we are only at the very, very beginning of understanding how the brain operates and how it works. And the tools that we have are just very primitive tools in terms of actually getting a glimpse as to what a working brain actually does. As an example, I mean, we can have a brain play chess. We can solve a problem. Well, we can build machines to do the same thing. As a matter of fact, you know, machines are better at being able to play chess than humans. But that doesn't mean that the machine, that the digital computer, is actually thinking. It's able to play chess because we can program it to play chess. And then there's the Watson computer that was able to win at Jeopardy as well. I mean, that's able to do what it does because it has the entire Wikipedia loaded into its memory, and it's able to search through that really quickly and make connections so that it can play the game of Jeopardy. But it's not actually thinking. It doesn't feel like anything to be Watson. And how do we know that? Well, we know that because Watson is a digital computer. And we know that these computers and these machines can learn, but learning is not the same thing as consciousness. Intelligence is not the same thing as consciousness. Artificial intelligence is, we're starting to see computers now that can do very well at artificial intelligence. They can recognize faces, they can learn to cope with situations and even design better computers. This learning potential can be built into a digital computer without it actually being aware in the same sense that you and I are aware. And there are some folks that would disagree with me on that topic. I've talked to a lot of the engineers who will say that it's only a matter of time before these intelligent machines that we're building become self-aware. And we see lots of movies where that actually happens, where, you know, to the surprise of everybody, including the manufacturers of the devices themselves, they actually become conscious. And it feels like something, and we start to feel sorry for these things. And, you know, so this spontaneously happens, that they spontaneously become self-aware. That's extraordinarily unlikely to happen. And by the time we're actually able to build anything that is conscious, that has free will and has all the things that we take for granted, we will have a pretty good idea of what it is that we're building, because it's very unlikely we'll build something like that accidentally. Now, to back up what I'm saying, let me talk a little bit about what the brain is. The brain looks like a big squished oblong shape. It's actually not. It's actually just folded into this shape so it'll fit inside our skulls. If you were to unfold the brain, you'd see that it looks more like a pizza dough. Actually, two sheets of flattened out pizza dough, because you have two independent parts of your brain. As a matter of fact, although you probably haven't thought of it this way, you really have two brains, right? They just happen to be connected in the center, but they're really two brains. They actually operate very independently, so you have two minds. If you ever hear somebody saying they're in two minds about something, that is actually literally true. We are in two minds all the time, which is a very deep thought when you think about it. It's a very unusual thing to think that they're actually two minds. You can notice that if you actually, it's much more noticeable in patients where they've actually had those two subparts of the brain separated, because they, you know, they literally do appear to be two individuals, sometimes even competing with one another, fighting with one another, over different perceptions of reality.
Is that side showing just one or both of those lines?
This I don't think is even a human brain. I think this is a rat's brain. Or maybe.
Okay.
But it gives you the same. It's the same idea. You flatten out this is the cortex where it's flattened out. And if you were to look at it edge on, then you would see that you'd see that it's organized in layers of cells. The body's made up of cells. If you were to look at a brain cell or a neuron, it looks very much like a regular cell. It has a nucleus in the center, which is where the DNA is housed. So it's the control center of the cell. And outside, there's all that the gooey stuff that holds the cell together, with the little machineries, the mitochondria that provide power for the cell. The interesting thing about neurons, though, is, you know, it's just a different kind of cell. The body can have stem cells and they can generate neuron cells. But whereas skin cells, the primary function is to form a protective layer, keeping the inside in and the outside out, and your kidney cells are designed to cleanse the body of impurities. Blood cells carry oxygen around the body. Neurons, their primary function is to communicate. They are communication devices. And so the interesting thing you'll notice about a neuron is a big long tail. It's a communication wire, if you like, or an axon. And that those wires actually stretch out from your brain all the way through your body as part of your nervous system. So that when your brain wants, when your conscious mind wants to do something, like if I want to raise my arm, what's happening is that my conscious mind, my brain, is sending a signal through what are called motor neurons. And that signal travels down through the tail, the axon of the nerve cell, the neuron, until it reaches the muscles in my arm, and then it causes them to contract, and I can get to actually do things and exert my influence on the outside world. So that's how essentially it works. The brain is using these neurons to send electrical signals to the periphery of my body. Now, within the brain itself, it's essentially, you see the same thing. Right, you're seeing neurons communicating with each other, only they're over much shorter distances. Right, instead of going all the way down to your leg, your arm, the signals actually travel from one set of neurons to another set, and then back again. And you see a lot of that back and forth communication in the brain, where the brain is sending out signals, and then sending them, and then it's getting feedback. Back to this image of the brain for one moment. Essentially, if I were to try to summarize what's going on in the brain, if you take the visual cortex, for example, you see stuff, right? When you see things, the retina responds to what you see, and it maps it onto a part of the brain called the visual cortex, which is at the back there. And so what you have is a layer of cells that pretty much the outside world, the field of view that you have, gets mapped onto that. But you'll have some cells. It's not like a movie where you know, you take a camera and literally everything that you see is mapped, projected onto the brain. The projection on the brain is actually a little bit more subtle than that. The brain looks for changes, right? So there are certain cells that respond to if something changes in the visual field. If something isn't changed, then there isn't necessarily a signal. So it's very economical in terms of the data flow, or unlike, you know, a VGA cable or a HDMI, which is just sending constantly, refreshing, sending all the information that the camera sees. The brain has special cells that can respond to this particular orientation or shape, like the edge of a table or something like that. It has other cells that respond to something that's moving. So as I move back and forth, there are cells in your brain that are firing because they're saying, okay, well, this neuron right next to me fired because it saw something, and now I'm firing because I'm seeing something, and the brain is now able to interpret that as motion, right? There was something that's actually passing across the field of view. And there are cells that, that just sit there dormant and they don't do much, but then as soon as there's a sign of motion, they react and they fire. And so generally speaking, what's happening in the brain is that the raw input, whether it's through your ears or your eyes, comes in at the back. And then the cells, as you move toward the front of the brain, are interpreting that signal. So whereas at the back you might find cells that respond to a shape or a movement without really doing much else, the next set of cells will then abstract on that. They'll represent, you know, what this actually means. And maybe you'll have a memory that's associated with a particular thing. And so the cells up at the toward the front of the brain, then they start getting very abstract about what do these things mean, and putting all of the percepts, the things that you see, the memories that you have, putting that all together into some sort of a comprehensive story that makes sense to us. So that's a real quick summary of how the brain is architected. So let's just go fast forward and give you a close-up of what's happening inside the brain. I'll go quickly over this stuff, and then if anybody, because you guys may know a lot of this already, and if you want to ask more specifics, then we can do that in the question time. But essentially, what people talk about to the brains and artificial intelligence, people talk about engineering another brain or uploading ourselves into computers and avoiding death that way. Usually they talk about neurons, right? And a neuron, just like we said, is a cell that has a cell body, and it has some fuzzy hair, which is on one end, which we call dendrites or the dendritic tree. And then it has this long tail, generally speaking, called an axon, and with a bunch of nerves at the nerve endings at the end of that too. So the input is up here and the output is here, if you want to think of it simply, right? So when you get signals coming in, at this end, if you get enough signals that the cell decides, okay, you know what, I'm going to fire, then it fires a signal, electrochemical signal down the axon, and that is attached to another neuron, or possibly several neurons, and then each of those neurons will receive a signal, so you get these cascading signals. Actually, every neuron in your brain is firing all the time, just to stay alive. So when we say firing, what we generally mean is it's increased its firing rate. It's getting excited about something. And to make things complicated, when one neuron communicates with another, it can do one of two things. It can either make the receiving neuron more excited, or it can suppress it. It can say, you know what, you're too excited, you need to calm down. And that is actually essential for the brain, because if you think about it, you've got about 100 billion or so neurons in your brain, comparable to the size of the number of stars in the galaxy. They're all firing. If they were allowed to just fire at will, the thing would get out of control, because there's a lot of feedback. You know, neurons that fire, and then other neurons that signal the other feedback. So eventually, you get that feedback squeal that you hear in the mic speaker sometimes, and your brain would start to have problems. And that is, in fact, what happens sometimes with people who don't have that sort of suppressive control over their brain. They can give you all kinds of spasms and things. So this suppression signals are just as important as the excitatory signals, and having the right balance is essential. So what this shows you is the point at which the axon of one neuron joins onto a neuron that it's talking to. And what actually happens is they're not connected, they're not actually physically connected. There's a little gap. It's called a synapse. And in order for one neuron to communicate with another, it releases or secretes these little messenger molecules called neurotransmitters. And they sail across the synaptic cleft like little boats, and then they connect up with receptors, which are these little host areas on the receiving cell. And so that's what's required in order for one neuron to talk to another. You got the neurotransmitters, and you've got these little receptors. And if there aren't enough receptors, then maybe the cell's not going to respond like it should. So when you talk about brain diseases, you often hear people talking about different kinds of problems that the brain has. It might be a deficiency of a certain type of receptor. There might be a deficiency in a certain type of neurotransmitter, which is pretty much where we're at in terms of neuroscience and neurology, being able to diagnose what's wrong with people's brains. You might say, well, it looks like you don't have enough of a particular kind of neurotransmitter. But by supplying that neurotransmitter to somebody in the form of a drug or something, you realize that you're affecting lots and lots of hundreds of thousands of cells, potentially. Right? So it's not a very precise manipulation at this time. But what's happening at the level of the cellular communication is essentially this. Across the synapse, you've got this communication. Now, that doesn't mean that the next cell is going to fire, because it's also receiving signals from other neurons, too. So the cell actually has, when it reaches a certain potential, when it gets enough signals that it thinks, well, this is significant enough, now I'm going to fire, then it fires. And then if you can then imagine this multiplied out, so you've got a huge network of all kinds of these dendrites and all the different neurons connected together. Each neuron can be connected up to maybe 10 to 100,000 other neurons, so it's a very complicated mess of neurons. That's what your brain looks like. So where does that get us? Well, we wanted to talk about consciousness. We wanted to talk about memories, because these are the things that are important to us. And one neuron talking to another doesn't constitute anything at all. So what is a memory? Well, as near as we can tell, what a memory is, it's when you have a bunch of these neurons, like this, for example, and they're all connected together. And then, like we said, when you invoke that memory, in other words, when you send a signal down, maybe one of these axons, it actually triggers a pattern, just like maybe Christmas tree lights. You plug in one, and then suddenly a whole bunch come on. And if you've got different sets of lights, well, you can only activate one, but just by activating that one, all the ones that are connected to that will all light up. And that pattern forms a memory. And so, how can a pattern form a memory? Well, you know, when you look at it in a movie, on Blu-ray or DVD, if you look real close at the disc, you don't see pictures, you don't see images. You see all these little dots. And so, really, even in our own technology, we have a way of representing images and sounds and stuff like that in terms of patterns, right? And that's exactly what the brain does too. So if you invoke that pattern, the brain interprets other parts of your brain that are able to interpret that pattern as being, well, this is the meal that I had last night, or this is the Chardonnay that I like, or whatever that memory is, comes back to you, right? As a result of these neurons all firing at the same time. And so when a memory is being formed, sometimes that's what it takes to form a memory. You actually have a signal that comes in from maybe two different neurons at once. And then the neuron that's receiving those signals says, okay, there must be something significant here, because I got a signal at exactly the same time as I got a signal from this guy. So that's pretty significant. So I'm going to remember that. And the way it remembers it is by the strengthening of that particular synapse. So the next time a signal comes in, it's going to respond a little bit more favorably, right? That's called potentiation. You might hear the term LTP, or long-term potentiation, and that is how you form memories. People who don't have that ability then are not able to form long-term memories. There are examples of folks like that who are not able to form any kind of memories at all. Right? They've lost that ability. Because the memories generally come in through a part of the brain called the hippocampus. And if you damage the hippocampus, there was a famous case of a guy who had a damaged hippocampus and due to some operation. I think he was 22 at the time when the operation happened. He wasn't able to remember anything then after that. Right? He could have a conversation with you, but if you came back later, you wouldn't remember having talked to you. He could remember the thing that happened before he was 20, when he was 22. And from his point of view, he was always 22, even when he got much older. He always thought of himself as being that a relatively young age because he wasn't able to form new memories beyond that point. His memory creation part of his brain was shut down. But that's essentially what memories are. They're synaptic patterns in your brain. They're patterns of neurons connected together, and each of those little connectors has been strengthened or potentiated so that they'll respond better the next time. There's essentially then two ways in which information is recorded in your brain. One is the very networking of the brain itself. When you're a child and your brain starts to develop, these networks will start to form in response to the stimuli around you. If you don't provide stimulus to a newborn, eyes, for example, then it will be permanently blind, right? If the brain doesn't develop in response to the stimuli, then it won't be able to after that. So that's the physical networking of the brain. And then there's this more plastic type of response where the neurons themselves can be strengthened or the opposite way. You can forget things too. I mean, there are synapses in your brain that are being desensitized because I guess your brain figures, well, you're not interested in this stuff anymore, so we're going to just get rid of it, right? It's cleared away. So that's that. That's essentially how our memories are stored in the brain. And our memories are essentially ourselves, right? Our identity. Because when you think about it, I mean, I'm talking to you right now, the only reason it feels like I am who I think I am is because I have some sort of thread of continuity. I can access memories. I kind of remember the first part of when we started talking, and I can continue on that thread, so it gives me a sense of identity. If I start to lose all those memories, then very quickly I'm not sure who I am. In fact, maybe I'm nobody. Maybe my identity is who I am. And so that's a sad part for Alzheimer's. If they start to lose all their memories, essentially they're dying, right? And if your brain is no longer able to retrieve memories, then you no longer are the person that you were, and you're dead. So that's one way to die, even though the rest of your body is still operating. Now, most of the time, I guess, the brain dies afterwards. I mean, you have like a heart failure or something like that, and your brain is deprived of oxygen, and then you die, right? But death, I suppose, if you think about it, is when your brain goes, because that's really where we live. That's where our memories are housed. Now, the other thing that's going on in the brain is it's not just a storehouse of memories. It's also a place where we, our conscious minds, or the thinking that we're doing right now, that's happening inside the brain too. Now, we don't know exactly what consciousness is, but what's the best working hypothesis that we have is that it's an orchestration of firing neurons, right? They're called action potentials, actually, is what neuroscientists call them. These electrical signals that are firing, that are shooting down from one neuron to another. So when you think about something, what's happening is there are these action potentials firing neurons. It's essentially it. So if we were to shut down the brain and make you unconscious, which actually happens every night when you go to sleep, then all of this action potentials, right, the firing, that subsides. So you're not thinking, you're not conscious. But that doesn't mean that the memories are gone. The memories are still there. You're just not activating them. You're just not, it doesn't feel like anything to be you. You're just asleep or you're otherwise unconscious. So you need those sort of two elements in order for you to be who you are. And so if you were to think about, okay, let's suppose for a moment that we don't think we're all going to go to heaven and we wanted to have another way of prolonging life and uploading ourselves into some sort of alternative reality or just extending our lives indefinitely, the things we would most have to focus on, the things we would mostly be concerned about are our conscious, keeping that conscious activity going on so we can activate our minds, think about stuff, and also preserving those memories as well. This is just another illustration of synaptic pattern. And this is a gentleman named Clive Wearing. He was a composer, I think, a musician, famous British musician, and he has lost the ability to record memories. And as a matter of fact, he can forget what he was talking about in the middle of a sentence. is his memory is only about, his short-term memory only lasts about 7 seconds, I think. Right? So if you've seen a video of this guy, that's his wife there. He, every time his wife walks into the room, it's like, you know, he hasn't seen her in months. Right? He greets her, oh, look who it is. And if she goes out to make some tea and comes back from the kitchen a few seconds later, it's, oh, it's, look who it is. Right? He's completely living in the now. Right? There is no, he has no real sense of identity. And the reason that I'm sort of bringing that up is that I'm not sure that anybody in this room has any disagreement with me when I've just said all the things I said about the brain being the seat of consciousness, and that's where it's our identity, right? There isn't any place else. I mean, some people might say, well, there's a soul, but I don't think you guys are into that stuff. So I think I'm fairly safe in saying that, you know, the brain is where it's at. There isn't anything else. It's just natural stuff. The process of remembering and existing is it's just neurobiology is all it is, right? And when you accept that, then you realize, well, the brain, as complicated as it is, it is just a machine. And therefore, you know, can we build machines? Can such machines exist? Well, obviously they can. We've all got one in our heads. So it's a question of, well, how could we build one of those things and how can we understand it? It is only a matter of time before we unravel exactly how the brain works. But to those who, I mean, if you're talking to folks who have any doubt about it, even though we don't fully understand what consciousness is, we do know that you can affect consciousness by affecting the brain. So there are these devices that can be used to switch off parts of your brain, little magnets. Or, of course, you know, people who have brain injury, because, you know, they've had their brains damaged in some way, and you can see the effects that it has on their personality, on those people as individuals. You can even interfere with somebody's sense of right and wrong. There's a part of the brain that if you ask somebody a question that requires moral thinking, moral judgment, and then you switch off a part of their brain, they have trouble actually figuring out what's right and what's wrong. So the things that we think are most personal to us in terms of our identity and our integrity even as individuals, you can mess with that stuff just by messing with the brain. What that tells you is that, yes, cognitive function and the things that make up who we are really literally just, you know, operations within our brain. The people that we call psychopaths, for example, you know, and not able to feel empathy towards other people, it's because there's something wrong with parts of their brain. In fact, you know, it's believed that it could be because of a deficiency of certain types of neurotransmitters. Anyway, this is what we see when we look back into the past. When we look back into the past and we start to see examples of humans using their brains, we see, this is probably one of my favorite, the cave paintings, where you see these animals, looks like this one is gently caressing this one with its tongue. This is a spiral pattern from Ireland, from the Newgrange monument, and this is some kind of curious vine creature. And then this is a drawing of some prehistoric burials in Russia. I think maybe around 60,000 or so years ago, and this one maybe around 30,000 to 40,000 years ago. And this, so these are the first examples that we've been able to uncover of you know, Homo sapiens. Thinking symbolically about things. In other words, being able to reflect on the world. That's the kind of stuff that we do all the time with our human brains. Our ancestors were doing that too, you know, if you go back 100,000, 200,000 years ago, they had essentially the same kinds of brains that we have. They were able to do the same stuff. So what for? I mean, why do we have that ability? And then, of course, you know, the Egyptians building these marvelous things here. This is actually a picture of sunrise during the winter solstice at a place called Newgrange. It's pitch dark for most of the year, except just around that winter solstice when the light comes in and it lightens up the inner chamber. It's a pretty spectacular thing to see. But that would have taken generations to build. It's a huge structure. There's 200,000 tons of rock actually in that new grand structure. You can imagine. But one of the things that got me thinking when I was writing the book is, why did our ancestors go to such great lengths? Why did they, for example, throw dead people into a hole in the ground and then put in all these precious artifacts along with them? The only rational explanation is that they thought that, you know, there was some, that this wasn't the end, that there was some sort of afterlife, a continuation of life beyond death. And we see that all the time when we look at the prehistoric mind. So why did people think that death was associated with, you know, that there was this afterlife? Well, it's all got to do with, again, the brain looking for answers, looking for reasons, and trying to, you know, figure things out. So you might say, well, why did the brain develop this ability? Well, as near as anthropologists and zoologists are able to tell, our brains didn't, you know, we didn't get these complicated brains just so that we could build, you know, cyclotrons or, you know, flat screen TVs, or for that matter, you know, we didn't get them so that we could, you know, worry about death. That's actually the last thing that nature had in mind when it gave us these brains. The reason for having brains that are able to figure things out seems to be very closely correlated with trying to live in bigger groups. So if we want to actually be able to cooperate together and live as a social group, we need a brain. Because some of the most complicated problems that we have to deal with are being able to figure out what other people are thinking and what they're thinking about us, and how do we fit in, and how do we get along with other people. You know, as a project manager for many years, those were the tough problems I had to deal with. It wasn't the technology, that was probably, it was, you know, all the politics and all the stuff that goes on with these clients that you have to work with. And of course, you know, when we develop technology, what do we do with it? Well, we don't use it to explore the universe or whatever. Maybe a little bit. Mostly we use it for things like Facebook and, you know, Twitter and communicating with each other, because that's what we do. That's what humans are about. That's what, in fact, all primates are about. It's about living together. There are, of course, huge advantages to being able to do that. Hunting being the obvious one, right? You can coordinate this hunting, you can trap other animals, and you can figure out where they're going, and you can feed people more easily if you're living together as a group. So there are lots of advantages to cooperating, problems you can solve, but it creates a huge problem for the brain then to try to figure out, okay, who's in charge, who's the boss, where should I even, you know, for baboons, where to sit can be a political decision, right, that can have long-term consequences. So you have to try to replay things in your mind. Well, did I offend this person? What did I say? Should I have said that? Maybe I'll say something different next time, right? These are the sorts of things that your brain is up to all the time. It's trying to predict what's going to happen in the future. And we can see that that's the case. If you were to get a whole bunch of monkey brains or monkey skulls and put them out on the table and arrange them by size, a monkey expert could tell you exactly what the size of the social group was by just, you know, looking at the size of the skull. Because that's how good the correlation is. So that's why we have brains. We have brains so we can live together in groups and all the advantages that come along with that. There are, of course, some disadvantages. Now, you see, humans are the best at this, right? I mean, we say, my grandfather used to talk about, you know, the wars and man's inhumanity to man and all that stuff, and talk about people behaving like animals. But in truth, humans are the most civilized of the animal kingdom, right? You try to put in a bunch of chimpanzees in New York City and there'd be a bloodbath, right? It just wouldn't work. But they don't have the capability to live in groups that size. Whereas humans, as you can see, we're able to do that for the most part relatively peacefully. So we are by far the most social species on the planet. And of course, the problem with that is that, you know, nature wasn't thinking about this, but, you know, when you set loose a device like this on the world and it starts asking questions about, well, what's the meaning of life? Well, as soon as you ask that question, you're demanding that there is one, right? When in fact, there might not be at all, right? And then why do people die? Well, why not, right? I mean, from nature's point of view, you know, there wasn't really any need to keep people alive forever. Nature's thinking about replacements. That's the whole process of procreation. It's about replacing. It's not about keeping you alive forevermore. So once you've had your kids, as far as Mother Nature's concerned, you're done. You're no more interested in your design parameters, okay, and keeping you alive a little bit longer. That's problematic when we start to think about it. So the brain and its power it gives us, it makes us maladapted for certain things. It's, we're certainly maladapted when it comes to trying to understand or deal with the problem of human fate and mortality. What it does give us is the ability to hunt very effectively and to control the environment, and we have mastered our environment, and we're now no longer worried about other predators. These are the sand bushmen. And they can actually tell, they can tell basically if an animal had passed this way because there's like a bent twig or some signs of the fact that an animal had, whether it was wounded, for example, they can continue to chase that animal for days even though they can't see it. Other animals don't have that foresight. They don't have that sort of deductive reasoning, so they're able to do those sorts of things. So that's, if you think back, 50, 60,000 years, that's the huge advantage that these brains have given us.
Yep.
I don't mean to be rude, but are you going to talk about mortality at all? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I was hoping you guys would see the link what I'm talking about here. Let's go a little faster so I can get then to the stuff that maybe you might find more interesting. Mortality, all right, we're all going to die. Now these are some of the reasons why people die, right? You can have tumors, cancer, you can have heart disease, coronary artery disease, which is the leading killer. Right, so, the difficulty when you start to ask that question, okay, mortality. A lot of people, when they ask, well, what's the meaning of life, and do we have to die, or can we prolong our lives indefinitely? What I notice is that people tend to ask the wrong people. These are the sorts of folks that get asked the questions. The physicists. I used to hang out with a lot of physicists, so I know they don't mind giving me their opinion, but they're not really the best people to ask the question. And why don't we ask these folks down here, the anthropologists and this guy here who's a neuroscientist? These are the sorts of people you should be asking about mortality, right? Well, the reason we talk to physicists, I think for two reasons. One is physicists are cosmologists in particular, are looking out into the universe. They can see what happened, for example, at the Big Bang, right, in creation. And typically when we think about mortality, humans that is, there is this association with God, right? For the reasons that I just mentioned. God's always came in. When you look back at all those prehistoric artifacts, there's always some religious meaning. Those cave paintings, they weren't just drawn because, they were really into art. We know that from the way those paintings were drawn and from the places in which they were drawn, they're very similar to what the Australian Aboriginals do. They went to very dark, inaccessible places, mystical places. It's all this mystique and culture and cultural magic. Sometimes they get themselves worked up into a trance, right? It's a way to actually decide as a society that there's something else out there, right? There's more to life than just what we can see, because if the stuff we can see is all there is, then that's just downright depressing. And as a kid, I hate all my conversations with my grandfather. It was like the same way. He went to church every day, but I was never surrounded by religious people who were really evangelistic or, insisted that they believe something. Even my grandfather, I'd say, well, is there really life after death? Am I really going to go to heaven and see you guys? And he didn't know. He was quite okay with saying, well, I don't know. I really don't know. Right? Maybe you'll figure it out. So that's what I'm trying to do. So these gods and so on, right, their natural instinct, I think even as atheists, when you start talking about the creation of the universe, right, well, that sounds very much like, Genesis, doesn't it? I mean, people get excited about that stuff, the creation of the universe. When I was a kid, I didn't even think the universe had a creation. But it turns out it does. The universe did actually start at a particular point. So that's interesting. And then you start talking about these the very basic nature of reality, protons, neutrons, those things, and gluons. They even found the God part, right, recently. So naturally, when people say, well, is there a purpose to life, and what happens when we die? These are the guys they ask because they're talking about God and party, and they must know, right? Because in fact, they don't really know. when you ask a physicist about God, they'll probably say, well, there's no proof, there's no, we can't really answer that question, right? But you're asking the wrong scientist. You're asking an anthropologist or a sociologist, and they'll say, yeah, we know what gods are. Gods are invented by people, right? That's what they are. Because they understand what religion is and why it exists. So Neil deGrasse Tyson, when he talked about, you know, is it possible to live forever? He said, yeah, of course it is. You know, and he said, well, in the same way that we can replace car parts, you know, just keep your car going, we'll put a new carburetor or put in a new fuel pump, we can do the same thing with human bodies. You know, and he's right. We have got to the point now where, you know, you can replace, we can build artificial organs, new esophagus maybe, or new trachea, or maybe you need a new heart. We're starting to in two different ways, we're starting to either use scaffolding or by getting a good handle on the signaling between the different cells, we can start to create growing organs in the lab. So let's say that we get really good at that. And you can start, you know, your heart gives out and get a new heart. Kidney gives out and get a new kidney. So his argument is, so that's the way we're going to cheat death, right? By replacing all these organs. Problem with that is it's a little naive, right? I mean, I might have a good heart to start with, but that doesn't mean I'm going to live forever, right? I get a new heart, you know, so I get a new heart. But I'm still living in a body that's programmed to die, right? I mean, that's we are built for obsolescence, and that's essentially what's going to happen, regardless of if we keep on replacing these different parts. So there's an example of things that we can grow in the lab. This is a new retina that people are able to grow. The fact is, when you get older, these sorts of things start to happen, right? And you talk about mortality. Well, mortality and aging are inextricably linked together, right? As you're getting older, you are, in fact, dying, right? Don't die all at once. And these are all the sorts of things that we've got to look forward to in our retirement years. And, you know, from as rational beings, this doesn't sound reasonable at all. You know, I mean, I pay into a pension plan and, you know, plan for the future, and this is what I've got to look forward to. You know, Mother Nature really didn't take into account our opinion on the matter when we were designed. And I keep saying designed, that doesn't mean I'm thinking of an intelligent designer, but we are in a way designed by natural selection. Mm-hmm. The workings of our body and the way we're put together is a direct result of natural selection. And so if there wasn't anything in the design parameters for natural selection, then it's not going to exist. So, and that would include being able to survive indefinitely. These are the only ways in which we actually, there's good evidence in which people can actually extend their lives by being fortunate enough to have genes that give you high levels of HDL, for example. There's a particular gene that plays a role in reducing oxidative stress. A lot of the things that you'll hear about being able to stay alive for longer, the experimentation that they've done with everything from worms to small primates would indicate that, yes, if you put the body into a state where it's actually trying to operate on a reduced budget, let's say, when times are tough, there's food shortages, and then those animals do seem to actually live extraordinarily long lives. They stop procreating and they switch more into survival mode. So the body does have that, those sorts of capabilities. And there's even suggestion that if we were to starve ourselves practically to death, make sure that we still get the right level of nutrients, that we could extend our lives. It'd be miserable existence, but we could potentially do that. Right? But you're not going to live forever still by doing this. And you won't live any longer just by having some good genes than the people who had those good genes to start with. You know, there's a genetic aspect to this. So let's back then to, okay, suppose we wanted to engineer a way to survive. And this lady, Lieutenant Uhura from Star Trek, I remember one of the episodes, she was offered an android body that could allow her to live for 500,000 years. And that seemed pretty cool. She ended up turning it down, I'm not sure why, but for a while there she was tempted. What I was thinking as I was watching the episodes was, they didn't say anything about her brain though. I mean, how's her brain going to survive for 500,000 years in an android body, right? That'd be problematic. So the real trick is being able to keep the brain, we're coming back to the brain again, how do you preserve that? Could you transplant a brain? Not so easily, maybe, right? Or make a new brain, if you wanted to do that, right? Well, this is what I'm showing you here is an MRI image. This is the only real way that we have of glimpsing what the brain is up to. And it's not very accurate. I mean, it's interesting, and it does provide information, but it only provides information on the level of blood activity, blood flow in particular parts of the brain. So it's not giving you a very high resolution image. You know, each of these blobs here, you know, contains tens of thousands of neurons. You can't see the individual communication that's going on at the neurons. So it's very hard to look at a picture like this and figure, well, what's the brain actually doing? But you can tell kind of more or less that there's activity in this area, and there's activity in this area, and you can make certain correlations, and you can compare it to normal pictures of healthy brains. And so this is definitely a useful tool for medical purposes, but it's not useful enough to be able to really understand how to fix every kind of problem that the brain might have. And it's certainly not useful for you to be able to give a glimpse into what's stored in the brain. So if I want to make a copy of your brain and preserve all your memories for the future and then reanimate you later in some future utopia, I don't have the tools to do that at this time. There are more advanced scanners that we're building all the time. This is pictures from what's called a connectome scanner. I think it's funded by the Department of Health, and it's, it uses an MRI, but it uses a little bit more of an enhanced method called water diffusion MRI, which is tracking the paths of water molecules passing along the neurons. It's still not very high resolution. It does give a sense of where the neurons are going, but all of these lines here are computed probabilities, and each one represents thousands of neurons. So again, you're not getting down to looking at individual connectivity between the neurons. So we have a long way to go before we can start to understand the exact connectivity at the brain. The things we are doing as far as brain interfaces and stuff are concerned are pretty interesting. There's a guy, Theodore Berger, down in Southern California, who's working on an artificial hippocampus. And the idea there is that you put in this chip, and the chip is able to receive signals from one side of the hippocampus and then relay them to the other side to bypass a damaged area. And the hippocampus, if you remember, is the part of the brain that helps you remember things. So if you have a problem where you're not able to remember stuff, it might be that you could have one of these neural or cognitive prostheses implanted that would start to help you to improve your memory. It's a very crude device still. You're talking about signaling whole bunches of neurons at once. But the nice thing about the brain is it's very adaptable. It actually can respond and learn to work with these devices, and you can, you know, it's like you can learn to make use of them. And then this other guy, the Brazilian scientist Nicolaides, who's working on machines that could allow paraplegics to walk. And what's interesting about his approach is that he is actually connecting to the brain. And so you're using the same brain signals that you would use to actually walk. You're sending those signals out to this computer that is making this harness walk instead. And then as you place each foot on the ground, it relays signals back. So that you can perceive the sensation of feeling the ground beneath your feet as you're walking. So that's, he's making tremendous progress in being able to do that, interfacing with the brain, in other words. So that's kind of represents the current state of our technology. If we were able to, if you guys really wanted to live forever, your only options are either you get your brain put into one of these freezers, cryonics, yes. And the thinking there is that, you know, you could put your head into the freezer and into liquid nitrogen, and then maybe in the future some altruistic engineers would pull you out of there, and once they figured out how to bring you back again and reanimate your mind. And so the question is, well, would this work? And the answer is, well, we don't really know. I mean, if you talk to neuroscientists about this and say, well, in order for it to work, you'd have to make sure that all your memories were preserved. Now remember, the memories are stored in the synaptic patterns. And it's likely that when you freeze the brain, I mean, they do put antifreeze into your brain, you know, so that does damage some of the cells. The question is how much is the damage? And is there too much damage such that you wouldn't be able to bring those memories back again? Are there any memories that are stored there that we'll be able to, I mean, well, we really don't know. I mean, the only way you know for sure would be actually to try it out. But since we don't have a way of actually even scanning the memories in the brain, and let alone, you know, reanimating them again later, there just isn't a way to know. You know, and so it might depend, maybe you might be looking, right? Get your brain frozen in a way that most of your memories or most of your identity is intact. So it's kind of a long shot, and it's pretty expensive too. So I don't know. That seems to be the only option available. The only other option would be, I mean, if we were all really dead set on not dying, and I definitely, for me, having thought about it for so long, it really isn't an attractive proposition by any means, just being completely annihilated. I think that, you know, a lot of folks, the reason they don't worry about it so much is either they put it out of their minds or they actually don't, we're not so good at actually understanding what not existing means, right? You know, when you die, you don't exist forever, and forever is what, I mean, it's forever, right? So you don't come back, there's no act two. And that's a horrific thing to tell somebody who is sentient, who's, you know, looking forward to a bright future, and then suddenly, you know, they've got to face this reality. But I think that people, you know, have difficulty understanding what it means to not exist at all. And I know that Jesse Baring, the psychiatrist, actually did some studies to prove that. And people not only have difficulty understanding or comprehending what it means to be dead, but they also have difficulty even accepting or understanding, really, that other people are dead. You know, because why is that? Because again, the brain. Remember, the brain was not programmed to think in that way. You know, I have a lot of family that live overseas, and I can imagine. I mean, even though I don't see them, I know they still exist. And that's what your brain is programmed to do. As kids, very, very young kids, they're not able to do that. They don't see you, you're not there, right? But then after a while, you realize, you know, well, they are there. They're just hiding, right? And or they're in a different place, and you can picture what they're doing. It's a different time zone even, right? That's what your brain is set up to do. So when people die, even though you know they're dead and they're not coming back, it's hard for your brain to actually really comprehend that, to really grasp that. And so if you were to say, okay, well, let's all get behind a project to deal with the problem of death. First of all, you have the apathy of people who don't really grasp that it's a huge problem. And then, you have the other problem that you've got folks like this telling them not to worry because the problem will be solved pretty quickly. We'll build these artificial brains in no time. I think he's saying we'll have artificial brains in like 10 years. I'm not so optimistic, right? Because the people who really understand the brains, and people who understand them will tell you a different story, right? People like Christoph Koch, who, you know, is doing his best to understand what consciousness is. He's gotten as far, by the way, as being able to say, okay, now for these rat brains, we can actually make correlations between some of the behavioral things that the rat does and these particular clump of neurons. That's about, you know, cutting edge, right? Rats can't tell you, though, what they're thinking. Humans can. You can't operate on the human, though, and start putting in, altering their genes in ways that would tell you which neurons do what in terms of consciousness. So the problem is not just that the brain is complicated, but it's also very difficult for us to figure it out, because you can't start pulling apart in their live brain, and, you know, ethically speaking, that wouldn't be a good thing to do. So it's a long, long way before we get to understanding what to do about making artificial brains. Maybe if we were to get all the Apollo guys, I mean, there's 400,000 people working on the moonshot, get a big bunch of folks like that, if we thought that it was a serious enough problem, but the problem is that a lot of people out there think they already have a solution, as you guys know. And, I mean, you have 6 million people over here standing around waiting to see this guy, right? And then you've got, you know, all these people walking around this cube here in Mecca, right? So they already think they have solutions, so they're not going to be up to spending government money on, brain scanners. The thing is, though, eventually, my thoughts are that we will, let me skip over Hugo Ross there. This sort of attitude that's kind of politically correct for most of us is, you know, certain mortality defines us as the truth of our existence. I don't believe that for a moment. Think that people have a chance and an opportunity that's a real opportunity to prolong their lives, they will take it. Because most of us don't live in a world where we're totally comfortable with our mortality. Most of us live in a world where we're not, we're planning, we're acting as though we're immortal, right? And the gods that we invent, by the way, I mean, the one interesting thing about them is they're usually immortal, right? They talk to us mortals, right? The one defining feature for God is you have to be immortal, because that's what's important to us. And when we have the opportunity to be like them, or to be the gods, I suppose you might say, then we'll take the attitude of the duck here, and we'll say, well, the way things are stinks. Because if there's one thing that defines humanity, it's changing things if we don't like the way they are. And eventually that's what we'll do. And why will we do that? Well, because it doesn't really take an Apollo moonshot program, right, to invent an artificial brain. That's only necessary if we want to survive, and we want it to happen in our lifetimes. But the reality is that over time, it'll happen anyway, because our engineers now are so well connected with the internet, and people are coming up with all kinds of ways to improve scanners that, and for other good, very good reasons. There are short-term reasons for wanting to understand how the brain works, right? Alzheimer's is a big problem. We need to be able to fix that. And so as we get better and better at understanding how to fix problems that affect the brain, we will, as a consequence, get better at understanding how to build an artificial brain as well, right? And I want to wrap this up here, but there's one last thing I want to say about brains and artificial intelligence, is that for me, writing the book was not so much about mortality, but wanting to just give people another insight into science as being a wonderful way to think about things. You know, and there are people out there who'll say, well, there's all kinds of ways of knowing, right? And I don't like that, right? Because, I mean, there are, yes, the Aborigines, they have a way of knowing, but it's not really a way of knowing. It's a way of experiencing. It's a way of feeling about, you know, having opinions. And there's a real sharp distinction between opinions and facts, you know? And when you want to start talking about the way things are, for me, I always wanted to know how things were for real, right? Not just, you know, people telling me you're going to go to heaven. I mean, for goodness sake, tell me what the real story is, right? And in order to do that, you need to have somebody not just tell you something, but to explain why it's a good hypothesis. Why does it make sense? What's the observable evidence? And the nice thing is that I think, you know, when you were talking about some of the stuff that you guys do, and you are part of what I can see is the world is becoming a more enlightened place. We are starting to hopefully put more weight on facts, observable things, evidence, right? And these are, I mean, some of the founding fathers of this country, Jefferson, John Adams, they were real fans of science, and they felt that public policy should be based upon empirical data rather than on opinion. Like this guy, when the muon was discovered, he says, who ordered that, right? I mean, the thing that distinguishes scientists, good scientists, is that even when things don't work out the way they wanted to, they still prefer that. I mean, Kepler is credited with being able to understand, basically, he explained how the universe works. I mean, Newton built on what Kepler discovered, the laws of planetary motion. But what a lot of people don't know is Kepler didn't like what he discovered. Kepler had this notion that he was very religious, and he felt that when he discovered the laws of planetary motion, that they were going to reflect the order of the Creator's mind. They were going to reflect the symmetry of the five perfect solids. No, they didn't, right? And he was the one to prove that. And he was deeply disappointed, right? Because he thought that what he had discovered was a bunch of garbage. I mean, it was a mess, right? The planet's going, it just wasn't as beautiful a solution as he thought initially would have wanted. And yet, he said, however, this is what's out there. This is what the evidence shows is real, and I much prefer this rather than my fondest dreams. Same thing with Carl Sagan here. It's not that, you know, when Sagan was going around saying, you know what, we may have to do without the gods, there may not be any gods, right? It wasn't because he didn't want to live. It wasn't because he wanted to, you know, he was quite happy with the idea of death. But, he just didn't see any alternative. I mean, any of the other things that, on these cultural traditions, despite the fact that we have all the millions of people who tell us that there is an afterlife, he could see nothing to suggest that wasn't anything more than just wishful thinking. And I think that way of thinking will serve us best in the end, right? Because otherwise we're deluding ourselves. And so science, I think there's a lot of folks that, even just the one last thing I guess you could say is that the other reason for choosing science over the alternative is that there is often a solution, right? As human beings, when we talk about something even as something as crazy as the idea, can we cheat death, right? It is something that that we can see is possible. In fact, as long as we don't destroy ourselves, it's inevitable that in fact humans will choose that course. And I often have people say to me, yeah, well, not everybody's going to choose that way of living. Some people will decide that death is what defines us. And I'm thinking, okay, well, those people, we know what's going to happen to them, right? Their opinions are not going to prevail for very long if they don't stick around. So the people who do want to stick around, eventually will turn our future society into a place where death is just a memory. It's like there was an age of death in the past when people used to die. I'd imagine they'd be pretty fascinated with us and the way we lived. But death is eventually a problem that will be solved. The only question is, can it be solved in our lifetime? And unfortunately, I don't think the answer to that is yes. I think that for me and for probably all of you guys, we will be some of the last participants, the last people to live the age of death, unfortunately. I know that other people have copped onto that too. Don Wertheimer made the same comment in Berkeley, over at UC Berkeley. There are some folks who resist that. I know that there's folks who have written books that will tell us that, you know what, any minute now we're going to be able to build an artificial brain. In fact, I had some engineers last year who told me, you know what, all this stuff about the brain, we don't need the brain. We'll just build computers and they'll get more advanced, and then eventually we'll figure out a way to make the thing such that it's alive, and then we can start uploading ourselves into those sorts of machines. The difficulty, of course, with that is that digital machines are very different from computers, right? Information processing is not really what our conscious minds are. I can take out a pocket calculator and I can 2 + 2 = 4. The device isn't doing the computation, it's just I'm interpreting it that way. But what's really happening is you just have electrical circuitry that's moving around, and liquid crystals are getting maneuvered and stuff like that. That's not what consciousness is. Consciousness is a real thing. It's a biological, neurobiological reality, right? It's not just an illusion. People will say, well, consciousness, maybe it's just something that's, not that important. If we have machines that they walk like a duck and they quack like a duck, maybe it's a duck, right? Maybe it's conscious. But the problem is, we can build machines that operate very much like they're conscious, but they're just machines. They're just doing things that look like they're thinking, but they're not really thinking. We've done that already with machines that play chess. They can play chess, but they're not really thinking. And we know they're not really thinking because all they're doing is they're manipulating numbers, number crunching machines. So we need to move way beyond that in order to produce something that's conscious. It needs to do what the brain is doing, right, in order for it to be conscious. So that's the kind of artifact that we need.